Good evening and welcome to Take a Deep Breath. I'm your host, Karen Faridin. My co-host, Chuck Gallagher, can't be here this evening. We have a very, very busy show for you tonight, very ambitious show. And so I just want to tell you before we jump in that the phone number, if you want to call in with your questions, is 610-378-0426. That's 610-378-0426. And so the first thing I want to introduce is what our topic is tonight. Our topic is A Tale of Two Pipelines. We're going to be talking about the Atlantic Sunrise Pipeline that affects Lancaster and Lebanon County and Schuylkill County to our west. And then we're going to be talking about the Mariner East Pipelines, which is actually a combination of pipelines that affects Berks County as well. And so I wanted to show a slide, if I could. And I haven't figured out how to maximize the slide, so you're going to see PowerPoint and all of its fixins. But if you could put that map up on the screen, that's the Atlantic Sunrise Pipeline we're going to be talking about. And that one is a 197-mile pipeline that carries natural gas or methane. And that's a fairly typical kind of a pipeline for this part of the world. And so what we're going to be talking about in addition to that is one that affects Berks County. It's a little unusual, and that's the Mariner East Pipeline. There we go. With tech support, we're now able to show you the full screen. So that's Atlantic Sunrise. And the next one down is Mariner East. And you can see that one goes across the entire state. That one is different from the Atlantic Sunrise Pipeline in that it carries natural gas liquids. And so what's so important to recognize about natural gas liquids is that that is a different kind of product from methane gas. It's propane, butane, and ethane, which is a very important product in the state right now. And so you can see that the map is just, there's a line across the map. The blue line is Mariner East 1 pipeline that's already in the ground, and we'll talk about that. And then the longer red dotted line is Mariner East 2. That's one that's affecting areas in the county right now and in other counties around here where they're doing construction and having some problems. So we'll talk about that. But before we do, I wanted to have somebody who's very knowledgeable about all of this explain to you how these pipelines actually are a little bit more dangerous, or they really aren't more dangerous, but differently dangerous natural gas pipelines than natural gas methane lines. And so I want to pull up a very quick this is a very quick video I just wanted to show you. Featuring a fellow named Eric Friedman. He's from Delaware County, and he's very involved in a group called Middletown Coalition for Community Safety down there, where he has been working with people in the community to fight the Mariner East Pipeline. And that's Eric. He'll be talking about what makes natural gas liquids pipelines so specifically dangerous.
Explosive. It tends to concentrate close to the ground, unlike methane, which is lighter than air, and therefore has a tendency to disperse in the atmosphere. These materials tend to concentrate close to the ground. They flow downwind and downhill and can travel for long distances while remaining in flammable or explosive concentrations. They can be ignited by many ordinary electrical devices, things like cell phones, light switches, doorbells, vehicles certainly. And so all of those things can serve as a source of ignition for these dispersed gases.
So that was a very brief description from Eric talking about what makes those kinds of pipelines so dangerous and how the gas in liquid form can travel along and affect communities if it should happen to hit upon an injection, an ignition source. And it can be any sort of ignition source like Eric was talking about. It doesn't take much. Actually, we had one of those issues here in Berks County not that long ago on April 20th when 630 gallons of an ethane propane mixture leaked on the Morgantown Road in Reading, in the Reading area, and it was very fortunate that it did not meet up with an ignition source, or we could have had a very big problem on our hands. But there are lots of other issues, and so we want to jump right into all of it. But I want to talk to Hugh Brownstone first about the films that he made. This is a film that Hugh Brownstone made as part of a series on Mariner East, and we're going to talk about that, and we're going to talk about his production company, which is called Three Blind Men and an Elephant. And so I want to get to the significance of that. But before we do, I wanted to just tell you who the other panelists are in the studio. And we actually have some people with us tonight via Skype. We'll go to them in a little bit. But tonight in the studio, we have Ann Pinka, who's the co-founder and president of Lebanon Pipeline Awareness. And she's going to talk about all the activities going on in Lebanon County, and there are plenty. And then we're going to talk to Tim Spies, who's on the board of Lancaster Against Pipelines, another very, very active group working on the Atlantic Sunrise Pipelines and pipelines in general. It's what we kind of do these days. So we do have some other guests, like I said, I'll get to them in a second, but I just don't want to be flipping around the screens too much, so they'll bear with me, I hope. But I wanted to turn to you first, Hugh, and welcome you. Thank you all for being here. I could easily spend an hour talking to any one of you, so I hope you will come back. But there are so many issues going on right now with pipelines, it just seemed like it was a good idea to do the sort of overview. And so that's the idea of tonight's show. So you came to us a few months ago, interested in helping us to get the word out about fracking and all the shale gas development issues that we deal with. And then it seems like fast forward after a few conversations to now, when you have done 10 videos already that are already out.
Yep.
So first of all, thank you for doing that. We're going to show you the URL so you can go find these videos. You have to watch them. But I wanted to ask you, when I got to know you, you told me about the name of your production company, obviously, right off the top. And you and your partner, Claudia Davis, work, and she's our studio audience tonight. You work together to do these amazing videos, but under the name of Three Blind Men and an Elephant. So I know it has significance for the kind of multifaceted discussion we're having tonight. So why don't you explain how you came to that name?
Well, Karen, first, thanks for having me. Thanks for giving me another opportunity to say yes, because that's how we came to this. Filmmaking is the way we think we can contribute to being part of the solution rather than the problem. But let's talk about three blind men and an elephant. It's an Indian parable. Three blind men bump into an elephant. In some variations, it's as many as six, but we'll just deal with three. The first blind man bumps into the leg, figures it's a tree. The next blind man bumps into the trunk, he figures it's a snake. The third one takes a little bit longer, he bumps into the tail and figures it's a broom. And from these we can deduce any number of morals, one of which is one person's subjective truth might not be another's, and neither may be the actual truth. You can go on from there to things like what would have happened if all three had actually spoken to each other, if they'd used their other senses. Would it have taken a sighted man coming in for them to realize that they were blind? So the value of that parable for me, for us, is that we're really interested in understanding the totality of what we're seeing. And so often we only get one angle, and so often it's only the angle of our neighbors or our friends. And in taking on this project, we've been extraordinarily fortunate to have people who were willing to step forward and help us see different angles of this thing. It's not just a pipeline. It's not just Sunoco. It's not just Pennsylvania. But that's the parable which informs everything that we do. And we like to think that we inject authenticity, humanity, and maybe a little wit into everything we do. And we've been extraordinarily fortunate by having people like Christina and Nick Johnson and Ellen and Elise Gerhardt and many others.
And so talk about how you came to fix on that project of all the things you could have done. I think you went to a local meeting and you saw firsthand what was going on.
Well, so what happened is, I think like so many people, I had an initial reaction of, so what? There are pipelines going in all the time. But it was actually my daughter, one of my daughters, who first started to wake me. Now that's the grammatically correct way of saying got woke, but I got woke, they're very grammatically correct, but I got woke actually in September of last year when my older daughter, who's an investigative journalist at The Stranger out in Seattle, actually started reporting from Standing Rock. And as I saw with my own eyes what was unfolding there, because there were citizen journalists there, there were citizen drone operators showing things that we've never been able to see before, I thought to myself, oh my goodness, these people, not politicians, not corporate, just people were speaking a truer truth and were allowing us to see with our own eyes more of the elephant. And in 2017, a mutual acquaintance of ours, Patty Rose, who had been going on and on about pipelines. I love Patty, but I don't want to talk about pipelines. But she said, listen, Hugh, you've got to meet this person, Karen. And we met in the cafe of a grocery of a supermarket. And you convinced me that I didn't need to look very far to find an extraordinary set of problems, something that was maybe an elephant, maybe something else, right here in my own community. So it's really been a gift that you've given me.
Well, likewise, I'm so grateful to you for telling these stories that need to be told. And in a format, the thing that's so great about them is that they're sort of not bite-sized quite, but they're very easy to look at on social media, to share on social media, to help get us out of our little bubble a little bit. It's one of the issues that we always confront is that, you know, when you're on those social media, the people who follow you already agree with you. And so this way, you know, we're hoping to help spread the word to another audience that might not be paying attention. For that, we're so grateful.
It was and remains really important to us to reach people other than the people who already agree with us. We were talking about this just before we came on board. This is not a partisan issue. This is not Republicans versus Democrats. This isn't conservatives versus liberals. This is something much bigger than that. And Claudia and I have a basic premise that our viewership are reasonably intelligent people and have reasonably decent attention spans. So we've tried to make each of these webisodes short, but we basically just let the camera sit on the people whose stories we're actually trying to share. It's not our stories, it's their stories. The longest one is 20 minutes. The shortest one is 6. These people are all very different, and they are all extraordinary people, just extraordinary.
Well, you're going to meet some of them now, and we have some additional guests here. I just want to say one final thing, though. I can't imagine, because it hadn't happened yet, I can't imagine how surprised you must have been back in April when the company that kind of drew you into this, Energy Transfer Partners, ended up being the company that you were going to be telling stories of the victims of. And so that must have been quite something.
Well, imagine that one blind man bumps into the leg and all of a sudden hits his head on the trunk and starts to make a connection that there's something bigger here. It's not a tree, there's something bigger here. And at the end of the day, our hypothesis, our thesis is, this is not even about oil and gas, it's not about eminent domain, but it seems clear that it's about the demotion of real people and the rise of artificial people, corporations. We are no longer a government of, by, and for the people. That's kind of what this thing smells like yet, but I reserve the right to get a whole bunch more blind people before I make a final determination.
Well, we're going to meet some of the people that you have included in your videos to date. And so if you can put up the screen we have on via Skype, we have people visiting us from elsewhere in the state who are on the front lines of all of this in very different ways. So on the left of your screen, we have Ellen Gerhart, who is joining us from Huntington, Pennsylvania. And she's with a group there that's actually an encampment on their property called Camp White Pine that you'll hear a lot more about. There's also a pipeline protection group in her area that she can tell you about. But she's been confronting the company, and we're talking about, we'll say Sunoco probably a lot on the show, but what ended up happening a little while ago was that back in April 28th, Energy Transfer Partners, this was the reference we were just making, acquired Sunoco. So now we're talking about one company that is owned by Energy Transfer Partners and doing a lot of damage to Pennsylvania. So if you hear Sunoco, that's what that means. Anyway, Ellen has been on the front lines with Sunoco Energy Transfer Partners for a couple of years. And then to the right, we have Christina and Nick Johnson, who are joining us from Brookhaven, Pennsylvania in Chester County, where they have been in the crosshairs of a crazy thing that's been going on down in community after community in their part of the state, where the attempts to build Mariner East 2 pipeline have not been going so well, and they have an amazing story to tell, and they can fill us in on the latest details about what's going on down there with other families. But first of all, I wanted to ask you, Christina, if you could describe very generally what kind of things were you seeing in your community? And I'm not necessarily going to hear you all that well, so if you want to tell your story, but I'd like you to start from talking about what you first saw, the kind of activity, and you thought there was some sewer work going on in the area. If you could start from that perspective, that would be great.
Hey, Karen, it's a little hard for us to hear. It's choppy. Is it our turn?
Yes.
You can go ahead.
Okay, we're going to go. So in early May, we drove out of our development. We saw a lot of activity and found out that Sunoco had spilled bentonite clay, their drilling clay fluid, into our creek and onto residential property. And Brookhaven was never alerted through Sunoco. We kind of had to put our own pieces together and found out that the DEP did issue a violation, notice of violation, and that was a good week after the spill had occurred. We found out that 1,000 gallons were released into the creek of drilling fluid, and they were able to recover 500 gallons of that, and the rest is still missing, still underground somewhere probably. Part of our frustration was the communication, the lack of communication. There really was not, there was no transparency. Sunoco never told Brookhaven that this has happened. We were not even supposed to be part of this project, and they have lied to us several occasions on the phone, telling us, oh, everyone knows in Brookhaven that this has happened. We told your council, and that didn't happen either. So what we're finding to be happening continuously now, months later in other parts of Delaware County, is the same cycle of lies and deceit, things that they know that they're doing, and they're trying to get away with it. And thankfully, residents are getting together and keeping eyes and ears and communicating with each other to not tolerate this.
And I wanted to mention that, because I don't think I said it when I introduced you, that you have founded a group called Protect Pendelco because of what's going on in your community. Maybe you can't hear me.
No, I can't hear you. Here.
Yeah, we're having
some
audio problems. I'm having huge ones, but I don't know what
you're doing. I'm going to go with what I know. And
working
on
that. Maybe, Ellen, maybe we can hear you a little bit better and you can tell some of your story. So what we have with Christina Johnson over and Nick Johnson in Brookhaven is problems during the construction of a pipeline and releases of drilling mud. But you have been confronting an entirely different problem. And so once we know we have the sound quality worked out, maybe we can go back to Christina, but why don't you try, Ellen? Let's see if we're having better luck with you.
Okay. Here in Huntington County, we're more of a rural area, and we've had issues with Sunoco Logistics coming and offering us money for 3 acres of land, which include a pond, stream, and wetlands, and we refused. We were taken to court. The judge granted Sunoco eminent domain on our property. The company was also granted an injunction because we started tree sits to try to protect the trees that were going to be cut down. We were able to save a few dozen trees last year in March when they came and clear cut. there were several people arrested at that time. I was one of them. My daughter was one. Ultimately, those charges were dropped. This year, there's also, well, for an entire year, those trees that they were in such a hurry to cut have been lying there because they didn't have their permits yet from the Department of Environmental Protection. Those were just granted in February. With those permits, that gave Sunoco the okay to start construction. This year, they filed for and were granted a writ of possession for those 3 acres. They were also granted another injunction for those 3 acres. We are again initiating a tree sit, well, several tree sits, in order to block construction of the pipeline. At this point, we don't have any construction currently started on our property. They are, however, across the road from us. So, you know, they're still saying that they want to have this up and running by September. That gives us 2 months. And we do plan to put up a resistance against it.
So, I mean, these stories are just, I mean, it's just unbelievable to me that people are having to fight in their own communities to protect themselves. But Christina, I think we're able to hear Alan, so maybe if you could pick up where you left off, because I know I wanted to get Nick in here too, talking about the photo he had taken and all of that.
So we can hear you a little bit. And my mom is texting me. She's watching. She's like, she wants to know about Protect Pendelco. So, yes, that is a Facebook group to try to unite. We have found that some of our municipalities feel like we're divided because the pipeline is going through so many different areas. So if I were to attend a meeting in, say, Aston, I wasn't able to ask questions as a Brookhaven resident, even though my children go to school in Aston, the same school district. So Protect Pendelco is a way for us to unite and not be divided, and then to share our own resources. And so something that Nick and I have found frustrating is when we call our borough, our borough then advises us to call Sunoco to get the facts. And then when we called Sunoco.
Looks like we just froze.
Yep. Back to me. Hi, everybody. So it looks like we're having some technical difficulties with our Skype connection. So we'll take the opportunity while we're trying to straighten that out to talk to Ann Pinka and to Tim Spies here in the studio, who can fill you in a whole lot more of what we're talking about in the realm of pipelines. Because Ann, for instance, has been working with Lebanon Against Pipeline, or Lebanon Pipeline Awareness, pardon me, for a very long time to work on the larger shale gas issues, fracking, not just the pipelines. So you're sort of like me in that way, that you kind of work on all of it. And so I wanted to talk about what's going on in Lebanon County. I'm going to try to pull up a couple of photos that you sent along, because there's one that particularly interests me before we move on to Lancaster County. But the thing that really interests me about what's happening, let me get back to the PowerPoint presentation. The thing that really interests me is that we've been hearing a lot from the industry and now from our president saying we're going to build pipelines and we're going to use U.S. steel. So I just wanted to talk to you a little bit about what you're actually seeing happening in Lebanon. And so I'm going to just pull up this one photo and move on from there to the next one. Let me see if I can just go down quickly. Okay, so I just want to set up that what you're seeing there, I put a red, if you can pull up the photo on the screen, you see a red circle around a tag. And now I'm going to just go to the next photo, which is a close-up of the tag. So why don't you explain what that is, Ann?
Okay. To explain what that is, May of 2016, actually, we learned that there was a massive stockpile of pipes being put in our county. residents had told us, what are all those pipes? So we went to check it out and discovered that these were the pipes being brought in for the Atlantic Sunrise Pipeline, even though that was long before it was approved even by the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and it still is through its final approvals, but they were already stockpiling thousands of pipes in this area. And we actually talked to some of the truckers that were bringing the pipes in, and that's how we got to see these close up. And yeah, you hear all this hype about energy independence and economic opportunity and jobs for Pennsylvanians, and the pipe was made in Turkey. That's a Turkey manufacturer on the label. The pipe, it says made in Turkey on the bottom. And the trucking company hauling it in was an Ohio trucking company. So we really had to question where the Pennsylvania jobs were with you know, with that part of the Atlantic Sunrise.
Well, I happen to be half Turkish, so I can tell you for sure, Turkey is not in the United States.
No, I didn't think so.
And so, but I wanted to talk to you about, there's a very interesting case going on in Lebanon County having to do with a pumping station. And there was another group, Concerned Citizens of Lebanon County.
Right, just to give a little background, Lebanon Pipeline Awareness organized in 2014. And that was in response to the announcement of the Atlantic Sunrise Project. But shortly after that, we joined up with our sister organization in the county, which is the Concerned Citizens of Lebanon County. And so since then, we've been working together on both of the pipelines, because Lebanon County has the dubious distinction of being the location where these pipelines intersect. They cross each other in one of our townships. So we have both of those projects to deal with right now. So what's coming up for us, and this has been a long process, but one thing coming up next Tuesday, July 18th at 7 o'clock, this will be in the Mount Gretna Fire Hall in Mount Gretna. It is the long-awaited decision from the West Cornwall Township Zoning Hearing Board. And this has been such a long process. It stems back to when Sunoco first applied for the permit for the structures for their pumping station for the Mariner East project. They applied for that permit in May of 2015, although the structures were actually already built. So that launched this appeal process, which has gone through so many loops and turns, we can't go into all of that. It's gone through the zoning board, through the court, and now it's been remanded back to the zoning hearing board. We had three nights of testimony for this, and on Tuesday they are going to decide, basically, on whether Sunoco's Mariner East pipeline is a public utility or not under municipal law. And this is pretty big because, of course, that's what's been granting them the power of eminent domain. You know, and of course, our case is that that's not appropriate. The permit was wrong, and it should be revoked, and they shouldn't have this pump station, which, incidentally, has been operating. It started doing propane in December 2014. It started putting ethane through early spring of 2016. Still doesn't have its DEP air quality permit.
And you know, that's what's so maddening about all of this. I mean, you heard Ellen, you know, you heard what's going on in the construction, you know, of the Mariner East 2 that's happening in Christina and Nick's neighborhood. And all of this is happening for a pipeline for which the issues are not yet settled.
No, exactly.
A lot of them are not.
And yet we hear it's all regulated and being done by the books. And we have the best regulations in the country. But we have a pump station operating without permits.
So let's hop over for a minute, because I want to come back to the larger issue of eminent domain, but I want to get Tim in to talk about the very different kind of pipeline, the natural gas pipeline, Atlantic Sunrise, because some of these issues are almost identical, regardless of what kind of pipeline we're talking about. Fossil fuel pipelines in general bring with them lots of problems, lots of dangers. But your community has been, you're both influenced or affected by both, but you've been working quite a bit on the Atlantic Sunrise pipeline and putting up quite a protest. And I wanted to talk first about your organization, because you do some of the most creative things. Here's a photo, if you can put it up on the screen, just to show you what kind of an organization this is. It's amazing. This is a quilt I want you to describe to everybody that you put together pretty early on in your fight. So if you talk about the quilt.
Nick Martin, thank you, Nick, had an idea to do a quilt, not unlike the AIDS quilt. What we did was we got material out to people. We went to county fairs. We went to we had set up tables at fairs and whatnot, and had people take the fabric and either on the spot or take it home and bring it back, do artwork on it, expressing their feelings about the pipeline. And then we had three quilt makers, actually four quilt makers that assembled these squares into 5 by 5 foot panels that we then put grommets on so they can be connected vertically, horizontally. And we started off with one quilt panel, which went to Washington, D.C., coordinated with the Pope's visit to Washington. We took it down to Beyond Extreme Energies, the end of their 17-day hunger fast. That was the first time the quilt was public. The quilt is now 50 feet long, and we kind of stopped there because the 50 feet represents the permanent right-of-way of the proposed Atlantic Sunrise Pipeline. So this is a beautiful, colorful, artistic, creative expression of something that is the exact opposite, the destruction and of this pipeline. And nothing says Lancaster County more than a quilt. So it was a brilliant idea. I wish it was mine, but it's not. But this quilt gets so much attention from the press and from people that see it. This quilt's been to the climate march in Washington. This quilt was at the Clean Energy Revolution march in Philadelphia. This quilt has been to Roanoke for a Flatline the Pipeline Festival. This, everywhere we go, this quilt goes. And people flock to see it because it's also a way for a lot of people to express themselves that normally wouldn't take a stand and make a statement, but their statement's there in this quilt forever. And it's beautiful, and we love it. It's become very iconic for our movement.
That's great. So that's just an example of what you've done. And you really have, you know, you described it earlier when we were talking on the phone, you really have done this as a community. I mean, you haven't actually had, you know, people swooping in to help you from some of the big NGOs necessarily, some help, I'm sure, but, you know, not like some other pipeline projects get. And so this has really been a community effort, you against them.
Yes, and our strategy's actually changed over the last year. You know, there was a time when we really wanted people from outside, and we still need people from outside, but what we've realized and what we've learned from Standing Rock, I believe, is that if you don't have a grassroots community effort, if the people aren't with you, they've got plenty of people and plenty of guns, they will arrest you all day long. So until you can strip away that persona of activist and become a teacher, a construction worker, who you are, just a community member, you're not going to do anything. It has to be a community grassroots effort. And so we have decided that in our actions, we will not be wearing masks. We are who we are, and we're going to be very open and upfront about our actions. We're going to tell Williams, hey, next Monday, we're going to come down here, and we're going to stop you at this intersection, and we'll be there. We have nothing to hide. We're going to be very, very open about what we're doing and why. And just this past weekend, we took a huge step up in pulling the community in. There we go. We have collaborated with an order of nuns, the Sisters of the Adorers of the Blood of Christ. They have property in Lancaster County near Columbia. And we got to talking to them over a year ago. They realized, you know, they were looking at Standing Rock, and they realized, hey, we have this property up in Columbia, Pennsylvania, that has this pipeline going through it. And if you look at the nun's land ethic, it's like this pipeline has no place on a property with people that have this land ethic. And their own Pope has said that we need to do something about climate change and global warming. So we built a chapel in a cornfield right in the path of the pipeline. And so we've, and the, you know, with the permission of the sisters, that we've occupied this chapel, and we're going to occupy it as often as possible moving forward with prayer and you know, people to come just to, you know, and hold the space. Mm-hmm. And so we had this event Sunday, and we had over 300 people for this event. It was beautiful. It was incredibly powerful. Anne was there. It was a big success, and to be honest with you, we're just overwhelmed with the amount of press attention that we've got. So the movement has taken a big step up, and it's exactly what we need to do. More people. Now we have a lot of the faith community in Lancaster County on board, and that event has spread out, and we're going to get more attention. One of the big highlights of the day was we got the sisters from the Kentucky Bluegrass movement to come up. I don't know if people are aware, but in 2014, a grassroots movement led by a group of sisters, the Sisters of Loretto in Kentucky, effectively stopped a natural gas liquids pipeline, not unlike the Sunoco pipeline, in a state where they didn't grant Williams eminent domain, and they should not have granted the company eminent domain in Pennsylvania. If it was wrong in Kentucky, it can't be right in Pennsylvania. It's not a public utility, and in Kentucky they had the sense to say, no, you don't have eminent domain rights. So that killed the project. But we got the sisters to come up and join us, so I can only imagine that what a punch in the gut that must have been to see those sisters from Loretto here in Pennsylvania to stop you again. But it was a great day, and we're going to be capitalizing on that momentum, believe me.
And when you talk about Williams, let's just give a shout out to Williams Partners, one of the worst pipeline companies out there. I mean, they've just been brazen in what they were trying to do with this property that we were talking about from Sunday. On Thursday of last week, they had an emergency hearing in Reading because the company that does not have possession of the property yet wanted to take immediate possession of the property.
Yeah. They went to 45-page brief to the federal judge in Reading. It turned out to be the court in Reading, stating our chapel and our dedication service on Sunday the 9th as the reason why they had to have immediate possession of this property. So several of us and Karen joined us in the courtroom that day, and it became very obvious to us and very obvious to the judge that this was just an attempt to stop our First Amendment rights. It had nothing to do. They said it was going to do irreparable harm to the project. I mean, they're going to be digging, blasting through rock. They're going to be drilling under rivers and streams. Yet somehow this little structure on this cornfield was going to cause them irreparable harm. The judge saw through that and did not give them immediate eminent domain rights. However, this Monday, the remaining holdouts in Lancaster County are, I believe a lot of them are going to court. And what I'd like, since we're here in Reading, I would love for people to join us, get it to our Facebook page, Lancaster Against Pipelines. We'll have let people know what time these hearings are. We know some are at 11. They're going to be throughout the day. This Monday, we would love to have hundreds of people down at 400 Washington Street in Reading to bear witness to whatever decision the judge makes. And yeah, take off work, take a sick day, take a vacation day. That's what we need. We need people to make a commitment and get out of their comfort zone. Everyone needs to get out of their comfort zone and deal with, you know, what Hugh's talking about, what Ann's talking about. We just can't sit still anymore and let this happen. And that's what Lancaster Against Pipelines is doing, and we're asking the folks in Reading and anyone that's seeing this or hearing this to come join us Monday to let the judge know how the public feels about this eminent domain. It's just not right for Americans who work hard for their American dream to have a company from Oklahoma or Texas come in and say, this is not your property, you thought you owned it, you don't. It's just not the America that I want to live in, and we all need your help to get back to where we need to be.
And, you know, by the way, if you're trying to find the courthouse, give me a call. It's not marked. But anyway, And that's what's so outrageous about the story, especially Ellen's story, because what happened with them going to her property to take down her trees in March of 2016 was at a point when we were talking about a different company. We're talking about Mariner East, in this case, and Sunoco or Energy Transfer Partners. But we're talking about a company that really didn't, I think it's still not entirely settled, the company can even be using eminent domain. And at that point, the project wasn't even completed in any way, and this is something we see on natural gas pipelines all the time. There are various permits that are required. The state doesn't have a lot of authority over these pipelines, but they do get to issue these water crossing permits, and until they do, the project really can't be considered done or approved. And yet, in case after case, that month, the same month that they went to the Gerhardt's property, a different company, Williams actually, went to a property in Susquehanna County for a natural gas pipeline and took down trees. So in both properties in one month, they were taking down trees for projects that hadn't been approved yet. In the case of the one that happened in Susquehanna County, New York State, because it was going to go into New York State ultimately rejected the permits the next month, and the pipeline project was dead, and all their trees were down, and in fact, they're laying there. They haven't even moved the trees. They've cut down the trees that the family relied on for a maple syrup business, and they're lying all over the ground. And that's the kind of dismissive, sort of nasty insult added to injury in all of this.
And it's important to note, when the judge ordered them to stand back and allow the chainsaws to cut the trees down. Those chainsaw operators were accompanied by armed marshals that stood there with their fingers on the triggers of their weapons to keep these peaceful protesters and landowners from interfering with them cutting down their sugar maple trees that was their livelihood for a pipeline that is now not going to be built. So, sit with that for a second. Think about it. Mm-hmm. And come out Monday to the courthouse in Reading. it's time. We have to do something.
Yeah, I mean, I know you've been doing a lot of good work. I know you're sort of doing a reboot of something called Protect Our Pennsylvania.
Yes, and just to backtrack a little bit on that, you know, we didn't plan our scripts here at all tonight, but I love, you know, we're all tying this in together because we're all on the same page, really. Your talk about looking at the big picture, I mean, that's what Lebanon Pipeline Awareness has been trying to do. Just want to make it clear, it's not that we don't want pipelines in our county. We don't want them in anybody's county. We want to get off this fossil fuels and move on to renewable energy where we need to go anyway. So one of the things we've really tried to do is, as was mentioned before, we don't get a lot of information from the industry or anything like that. So we've really worked hard to collaborate with all the other groups along both the pipelines. We were at the Gerhardts the day they cut down the trees. We've been down to Middletown Coalition to talk to those people for the Mariner. And on Atlantic Sunrise, we work really closely with our neighbors in Lancaster County, but we've also worked with our neighbors in Schuylkill County and Columbia County, because that way we all know what's going on, we know what each other's doing, and we are stronger together, and we need to stand together to do that. One of the results of that is we have started this group. It's just fledgling, it's just getting started, but we're really excited about it and hoping that it'll be a good movement. It's called Protect Our Pennsylvania, or POP for short, and it's to work on closing the eminent domain loopholes in Pennsylvania with our legislation. So our ultimate goal is to get legislation in place that is going to correct these problems with the eminent domain abuse that all of these people are suffering under with pipelines. So we have a Facebook page for that. We have a little bit of information like right now, but you'll be hearing more from us in the next couple months.
Great. That's so exciting, because I mean, it's just such an outrageous thing. Under the proper circumstances, so to speak, people object to eminent domain, but when it's a private company making a profit, I mean, they're cheerleading the fact that they're sending this ethane from Mariner East to mm-hmm. Marcus Hook and shipping it to Scotland. There's no mystery about it. It's clear that it's not being used for the public good. I see that we have a home viewer. I don't know if we still do. Do we have a home viewer?
Yes. I'm sorry. Are you waiting for me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Yes, my question, this is Layla, by the way. My question was in regards to, you talked about getting out of your comfort zone. And I know there are some camps that have a preference to keep their group very small, whereas some camps really see the value in the strength of in numbers. And I'm curious as to what goes into making that decision. For instance, I know, based on social media, I know Camp White Pine recently mentioned that they want to keep their numbers low and they're not very interested in bringing new people in. So I'm curious what goes into making a decision like that.
Part of that decision is based on the fact that our camp has room for maybe 200 cars to park. So, like I told Senator Scott Martin, who thinks there's going to be 10,000 people in Lancaster County, I said, I got parking for a couple hundred. We know people from outside. We know people from all over the place will want to come once actions start. We understand that. But we also have to be very careful about who those people are, what they bring, and they have to buy into our values. They have to understand that this is a grassroots movement, and we can't go out on our own and turn away the local people. We must bring in the local people with our movement. So we have to be very careful about vetting who's coming in. And of course, as we know, there's infiltrators. We've got Tiger Swan working in Pennsylvania now. So we know there's going to be people that'll come in. So there's a really good reason to not have a huge encampment where you can breed chaos and disorder. So the encampment needs to stay smaller and controlled. And the people showing up at movements are people that take off from work for a couple days and come locally. It's a combination of the two, and it's a hard balance to strike. But I think what you saw in Standing Rock is there was an opportunity for people to come in and create a lot of chaos that wanted to do harm to that movement. And the logistics is we don't have room for 10,000 people. They just won't fit. So we have a smaller encampment, and we will be getting that camp up and going as construction starts. But for right now, we're doing trainings on the weekends. The first weekend in August, we have a nonviolent direct action training. I believe it's on our calendar, which we just got out, but I believe we have a mass orientation coming up the weekend after that on Saturday. So we're doing trainings and get to know us kind of things in the weekends. We'll be ramping up, later on. But we don't need a 10,000 person camp. We need a smaller camp, and we need the public in the area to come out and join us. And that's exactly what happened Sunday.
And you have an area already that you call.
Excuse me?
You call your area that you already have set up for this, the Stand?
This is called the Stand. We have two Facebook pages. It's Lancaster Against Pipelines or the Stand, and our website is wearelancastercounty.org. And you can message us if you have any questions about what we're doing.
And we have lots of busy people with lots of websites tonight. So at the end, I'm going to flip up a screen that shows you all of the various websites. But I wanted to turn it back over to Ellen because I wanted you to talk about Camp White Pine, PA, if you would, to follow on what Tim was just talking about.
With us, it's a similar situation. We have, we had to make a decision whether to have what's called an open camp or a closed camp. And again, I mean, it's on our property. We have 27 acres, so we can't handle 10,000 people either here. But again, with a closed camp, it's closed in the sense of we try to make sure that anybody who comes has been vouched for, because again, we don't want to create any problems with the neighbors. We really don't want to create a problem with the Huntington County Sheriff's Department. So we try to make sure that the people that are coming for the right reasons. And, there's not going to be a problem. Camp White Pine is similar to the Stand in that we have people who will be here for a certain length of time, whatever time they can give, and then they leave and they're replaced by somebody else. So we have a fluctuating camp population, which sometimes drives me crazy because I have trouble remembering people's names as it is. But it's a controlled situation, and that's the way that we feel comfortable doing it that way, and not just throwing open the gates and saying anybody that wants to come, just show up at our doorstep. We are putting up a resistance to this pipeline going through. People are in real danger of arrest for this. We are planning direct action. But again, we have guidelines. We have guidelines on what's acceptable actions and what are unacceptable actions. And if anybody's interested, we have also two Facebook pages. Actually, we have Camp White Pine PA, and we also have Juniata Watershed People Before Pipelines. That was actually the original one before the Camp White Pine started. There's also Resist Sunoco PA. So any one of those websites you can get on, and you can get more information about the camp.
And I want to turn to you, Christina, because you actually said something in the video that Hugh made. It's a line that I just love, and it speaks to what Ellen's talking about, what Tim's talking about, everybody here is talking about. And you said in the video, "Where do you go in a state that's not making it safe for you? When the government is not protecting you, where do you go?" I mean, that just says it all. And so you don't go anywhere, is the answer. That was your answer. That's the answer of everybody here tonight. You stay and you fight. And so I know I wanted to show a slide if I get the chance after you get a chance to speak, because we've had so many Skype problems. I'm sorry you didn't get more of a chance. But a lot of this is around, surrounding, and this is something you might want to talk about a little bit, Hugh, about the video that Eve made, where she talks about your community. You don't just live in your house. You don't just live in one property. You use an entire community, even if the pipeline is not in, like an Ellen situation, on your property, but it's under your highway, or it's next to your swim club, or, you know, I mean, it really affects entire communities when one of these projects comes along. I don't know if you wanted to say anything about that.
Well, it's been absolutely eye-opening. Eve is a mama bear. It's really interesting to see what
she
role.
Is.
and so are you, Christine, and so are you, Ellen. It's not uninteresting to me that women, that mothers, seem to be stepping up. My personal view is that if women fully step up, everything's going to be solved. There'll probably be other problems, but okay, we'll deal with those. But it is fascinating. Nobody's perfect.
I'm staying away from that one.
But it is fascinating, and it is right to say that you don't live just in your house, Netflix notwithstanding, that you go out to restaurants, you go to parks. At the end of Eve's particular segment, we shot footage at a local orchard, and there are pipelines right there, and people love to take their children there to do apple picking or to get fresh strawberries. So it's absolutely extraordinary that you have Sunoco or you have local politicians trying to control the narrative and trying to control the flow of information. I was recently at a homeowners association meeting at a very large retirement community. No point in not saying it, it's Hershey's Mill. The homeowners association had Sunoco come in. This is a community of 3,000 people. It's an upper middle class or maybe affluent gated community. But there is no separation between rich and poor, rural and urban, suburban when it comes to eminent domain and the perverted use of eminent domain. In this community of 3,000, 10 people showed up. But 10 people showed up because the president of the homeowners association had only invited 10 people. Mm-hmm. So what is community? Mm-hmm. What is community? What is community when you think you're part of a lovely gated community and your own people are channeling and constricting the flow of information.
Mm-hmm. And I wanted to give, because we're down to about 4 minutes, I wanted to give Christina a chance to speak, since we really didn't have a chance to hear you very well earlier. But, I mean, you're just committed to protecting your communities, are you not? That's you have started Protect Pendelco to that end.
Absolutely. And you know what, to bring up the part, Eve was sitting next to me. I was involved with this without knowing how close I was to this. And Eve was sitting next to me when I finally got my hands on a map that was hard to find. I think everything was very vague. And when I looked at the map and I saw the pipeline and I saw my house this close, like a fingernail away, and she like held my hand. I think I was rocking at some point saying, oh my God, I really am really close to this. So when Hugh mentions Eve, who may not have it right in her yard, but she was there to open my eyes to, now what are you going to do? Now move forward and spread the word. And so to move off of that, of yes, I did start Protect Pendelco, to join along with other groups, and now we're meeting each other in different places and sharing ideas. And it's a beautiful way to connect. It's a frightening that we have to connect this way. But I believe that, you know, the strength in numbers of how many passionate people we are, whether we're mama bears or papa bears, or, you know, or not even really knowing what we're getting involved in. I love the way we're doing it, even though we're doing it against a company that's so dirty with their way of doing things. And I think that the faith and the belief that we're going to achieve so much more the right way is something that makes me sleep at night.
Thank you so much. We're down to about 2 minutes, and I want to show a quick picture, if I can, from something called fracktracker.org. It shows what we're talking about here. It's a couple of screenshots I took off of Frack Tracker, so you could see what we're talking about with respect to how close some of these schools are, for instance, to this pipeline route. So this is a picture of the entire route. You see lots of pointers there. The blue ones are public school, private schools. The purple ones are public schools. Now you see lots of them, but once you start drilling down, you no pun intended, you get to see just how many there are. And so there's this one that kind of jumps out, and you see that band there. That's the impact zone. That's the blast radius. But you see one kind of there right by the Hershey Golf Club, and that one, if you were to click on the pointer, if it was their live map, you would see that that is a Catholic school called Saints Peter and Paul. It's in Westchester, and it sits 7 feet from the pipeline. And there are 389 kids who go to that school, not to mention all the faculty and staff. So that's what we're talking about. This is a real assault to our communities. I want to thank everybody for being here tonight. I wish I had more of a chance to give you a final word, but we had no shortage of things to talk about. Nope. And so I'm going to, right before we end, I promise to put up a slide that has all of the websites. And so I'm going to let you see that as we close out the show, and I'll have to drive back down there very quickly. But please jot down the websites. I'll put it on the Facebook page for the show in case you miss it. And you can watch the show on YouTube starting tomorrow, and you'll be able to freeze the screen and write them all down then. So if you miss them right now, you have another chance. And there's the screen with all of it. So thank you. Anne, Hugh, Tim, Ellen, and Christina, and Nick, thanks to our studio audience. Claudia Davis. Good night, everybody. See you next time.
All right.